Yeah, we are live on YouTube. So should we start?
Yeah, sure.
Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. And this is Pursue 13F, which is head and neck pathology. And we are streaming live from Tata Medical Center, Kolkata, India. And today's topic is very interesting. And it is going to be presented by Dr. Indu Arun. She is an MBBS, MD, PDF from Tata Medical Center, Kolkata. Dr. Indu Arun completed her MD in pathology from Government Medical College, Kottayam, Kerala in 2007, followed by a research fellowship in flow cytometry at NCI, NIH, Bethesda, USA. In 2009, she moved to Kerala, where she worked as a senior resident in the Department of Pathology, Government Medical College, Thrissur. She then completed a specialty fellowship in oncopathology at Tata Medical Center, Kolkata. And subsequently, she continues there to be a senior consultant, a very well-known person with special interest in breast, lymphoma, and head and neck pathology. So who better than her to talk on head and neck pathology? And the topic of the day is Born in the Bone, the Odontogenic Tumors. Before I ask Dr. Indu Arun to start, let me request you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Dr. Indu Arun, ma'am, please share your screen and let us start.
Thank you, Dr. Nadeem, for your kind introduction, and thanks for having me here.
Yeah, we can see your screen. Yeah.
I'll open my presentation.
That's right. Make it full screen, please.
Yeah.
And just press that height so that the... Yeah, fantastic. Please start. You can change the pointer if you want.
Okay. I'm not able to change it.
Okay, doesn't matter.
That's fine.
Yeah, that's fine. That's fine.
So, good evening, everyone. So, today, I'm going to start off with a bit of trivia which is related to the title of my talk today, which is known as Born in Bone, Odontogenic Tumors and Cysts. I chose this title because odontogenic tumor is the only situation in pathology where a primary epithelial tumor may be found within bone. And this is because they are derived from epithelial and mesenchymal elements of the tooth-forming apparatus and are found exclusively within the maxillofacial skeleton. But this is not very trivial. If you look at the WHO classification of odontogenic tumors, there are more than 20 named entities in addition to their subtypes. And some of them are so rare that you may not encounter them in your whole lifetime of practice. In addition to that, WHO has also included odontogenic cyst in the classification. So WHO has classified odontogenic tumors broadly into malignant odontogenic tumors, which include odontogenic carcinomas, odontogenic carcinosarcoma, and odontogenic sarcomas. Among the benign odontogenic tumors, we have benign epithelial odontogenic tumors, benign mixed epithelial and mesenchymal odontogenic tumors, and benign mesenchymal odontogenic tumors. Among the odontogenic cysts, we have odontogenic cysts of inflammatory origin and odontogenic and non-odontogenic developmental cysts. So the histology and therefore the classification of odontogenic tumors depends upon the interaction between odontogenic epithelial and mesenchymal components, and this process is known as inductive change, which results in cytodifferentiation that recapitulate structures of normal tooth-forming apparatus or enamel organ. So odontogenic tumors are classified into those which are derived from odontogenic epithelium, those which are derived from odontogenic mesenchyme, and those which are derived from both odontogenic epithelium and mesenchyme. Hence, the presence of ameloblast-like cells and dental heart tissues like dendine are indicators of odontogenic origin of epithelial lesions encountered within the jaws. Since these tumors and cysts arise from structures of normal tooth-forming apparatus, a basic knowledge about the different stages of odontogenesis and the embryology is important, may better help to understand the histology and development of these tumors. So the tooth formation begins as a thickening of the oral epithelium at the site of the future tooth row. And here the neural crest mesenchymal cells condenses below the epithelium. to form the dental plug cord in the plug cord stage. Next stage is a bud stage, where this dental epithelium, which is also known as dental lamina, buds into the dental mesenchyme. Later, this grows into a cap-shaped structure, which encompasses or invaginates the dental mesenchyme, and this cap-shaped structure is known as enamel organ. And dental mesenchyme is now known as dental papilla, and the surrounding connective tissue is known as dental follicle. So this cap-shaped structure later develops into a bell-shaped structure as a result of differentiation of the enamel epithelium into ameloblastic epithelium, which starts to secrete enamel. And the outer layer of the dental papilla, or the peripheral layer, differentiates into odontoblast, which starts secreting dentine. And this bell stage is followed by the crown and root formation. Crown formation followed by the root formation, which is the final stage of root tooth development. So there are three parts of tooth bud. That is the enamel organ, that is, as I discussed here, this this secretes the tooth enamel. The dental papilla forms the pulp and dentine, while the dental sac, that is the dental follicle, forms the cementum and the periodontal ligament. So this picture shows the bell stage of odontogenesis, where you can see the bell-shaped enamel organ, which is lined by four layers of epithelium. That is the inner enamel epithelium. Then there is a thin layer of epithelium known as a stratum intermedium. Then there is a broad layer of loosely arranged cells known as stellate reticulum. And the outermost layer is the outer enamel epithelium. Here you can see the dental lamina cells, cords of dental lamina epithelial cells attached to the enamel organ. And this is the dental papilla. And here is the dental follicle. So this is the higher power view of this area, particular area of the enamel organ. So here you can see the inner enamel epithelium differentiating into the ameloblastic layer, which secretes enamel, and the outer layer, the peripheral layer of dental papilla, as a result of its association with the ameloblastic epithelium, differentiates into odontoblast, which starts secreting dentine. So normally, after formation of the enamel organ, the cord of dental lamina epithelium, it undergoes fragmentation and usually disintegrates. Sometimes they may persist, which is known as the epithelial rest of series, which give rise to supernumerary teeth and odontogenic cyst and many odontogenic tumors. So with the formation of dentine, when more dentine and enamel are formed, it results in the collapse of the stellate reticulum, and the inner enamel epithelium, or the ameloblastic layer, fuses with the outer enamel epithelium to form a thin layer, which is known as the reduced enamel epithelium, which covers the crown of an unerupted tooth. In the normal sequence of events, this reduced enamel epithelium fuses with the surface epithelium after the eruption of the tooth and forms the initial gingival crevicular epithelium of the newly erupted tooth. So now after the formation of the crown, root formation begins, and the rim of the enamel organ, where the inner enamel epithelium fuses with the outer enamel epithelium, comes in contact with the inner outer enamel epithelium, is known as the cervical loop. And this cervical loop epithelial cell starts to proliferate, and this gives rise to Hertwig's epithelial root sheath. And this initially in the epithelial root sheath cells starts to proliferate and bends at 45 degree to form the epithelial diaphragm. The free end of the epithelial diaphragm stops growing. However, the root sheath epithelial cells continues to proliferate. So as a result of the proliferation of the epithelial root sheath cells, it induces the differentiation of the odontoblasts, the dental papilla cells, outer layer of the dental papilla cells, to differentiate into odontoblasts, which starts to produce dentine. And as a result, the root sheath cells, which are adjacent to the dentine, starts to disintegrate, and they move away from the root surface. This results in the dental follicle cells to come in contact with the dentine, and they differentiate into cementoblasts, which starts to lay down cementum. However, some of these root sheath epithelial cells persist in the root area, and they develop into epithelial rest of melasse, and these are also responsible for the development of many epithelial cysts and tumors. So the odontogenic cysts and tumors develop from the dental laminar remnants known as the epithelial rest of series, such as ameloblastoma, ameloblastic fibroma, calcifying epithelial odontogenic tumor, odontogenic keratosis, and gingival cyst are thought to arise from the remnants of dental lamina. Dentigerous cysts arise from the reduced enamel epithelium, which I already discussed, and the radicular cyst and squamous odontogenic tumor arise from the rest of malacic. In addition, many odontogenic tumors and cysts also arise from the tooth germ itself, which include the dental papilla, enamel organ, and dental follicle. If you look at the epidemiology, odontogenic tumors are very rare tumors. They constitute only 1% of all specimens and 5% of jaw lesions. Among the odontogenic lesions, odontogenic cysts are most common, constituting 80%. And if you look at the relative frequency of various odontogenic tumors by geographic location, odontomas are most common tumors in the West, while ameloblastomas are more common in the developing countries. This is because odontomas are generally considered as malformations or hamartomas rather than a true neoplasm, and they are less frequently submitted for histologic examination in developing countries. So the most common true neoplasm is ameloblastoma, which constitute 20% of all odontogenic tumors. So now let's discuss benign odontogenic tumors. Benign epithelial, out of which first we'll discuss benign epithelial odontogenic tumors, which have which includes ameloblastoma, squamous odontogenic tumor, calcifying epithelial odontogenic tumor, and adenomatoid odontogenic tumor. Ameloblastomas are again subclassified into conventional, solid, and multicystic, and unicystic variant, extraosseous and peripheral variant, and metastasizing variants. So now let's discuss ameloblastoma, the conventional variant. It is an aggressive benign tumor because it is locally infiltrative and can undergo malignant change. Peak age of occurrence is 35 years, and it occurs in young adults and young and middle-aged adults. However, they are rarely reported in children. 80% of the cases occur in the mandible, with the majority, about 66% of cases, occurring in the molar and the ramus area. Clinically, they present as painless jaw swelling with tooth mobility, trismus, paresthesia, and soft tissue invasion. And large tumors can cause pain, marked facial deformity, and uncommonly airway compromise. Small lesions may be asymptomatic. Radiologically, the conventional ameloblastoma may be either a multilocular or unilocular radiolucency with well-defined borders, and the localizations may be large, appearing like a soap bubble, or they may be small, resembling a honeycomb pattern. There can be tooth resorption and displacement, and cortical expansion are common. Grossly, they can be solid infiltrating tumors with or without cystic change. There are six main histopathologic types: follicular pattern, plexiform pattern, acanthomatous, granular cell, basal cell, and desmoplastic types, out of which follicular and plexiform patterns are the commonest types. Out of two or more patterns can be observed in any individual tumor, and the histologic subtype does not impact prognosis. Follicular variant of ameloblastoma is characterized by discrete islands of odontogenic epithelium interspersed within a mature collagenous connective tissue stroma, and the epithelium shows peripheral palisading and peripheral nuclear palisading and reverse polarization, that is the nuclei are facing away from the basement membrane, and also shows basal cytoplasmic layer vacuolation, as you can see here. Then central part of the island shows loose stellate or angular epithelial cells resembling stellate reticulum of developing enamel organ. Edema and microcyst formation are common. In the plexiform variant, you can see long interconnecting strands and cords of odontogenic epithelium surrounding more loosely arranged epithelial cells, and the supporting stroma is loosely arranged and vascular. In the acanthomatous type of ameloblastoma, the central stellate reticulum-like area of the ameloblastic epithelium, ameloblastic island, undergoes squamous differentiation. As you can see here, this is a high power view of this particular area, where you can see the squamous differentiation and keratin pearl formation of the stellate reticulum like area. However, this is the higher power view of this particular area, where you can see the typical ameloblastic or odontogenic epithelium with peripheral palisading and reverse polarization, and stellate reticulum like areas. In the granular cell type, there is a granular cell change of the stellate reticulum like area, where the cells acquire abundant eosinophilic and granular cytoplasm. Basal cell type of ameloblastoma is extremely rare, and it is characterized by interconnecting strands and cords of hyperchromatic basaloid cells, and sometimes they may show peripheral palisading, but no stellate reticulum like cells are seen, and hence it can mimic a basal cell carcinoma. Then the desmoplastic variant of ameloblastoma is the last variant, which is composed of numerous compressed islands and cords of hyperchromatic odontogenic epithelium within a hypocellular and collagenous stroma, which compresses these epithelium becoming cord-like structures. And it was found that these tumors secrete cytokine. There is an increased production of a cytokine that is a transforming growth factor beta, which may be responsible for this desmoplasia. In addition, osseous metaplasia can be seen. Desmoplastic ameloblastomas are different from the conventional variants of ameloblastoma in terms of the radiologic finding. Because of the increased stromal density and osseous metaplasia, they show a mixed radiolucent, radio-opaque appearance with well to ill-defined borders and resembles a fibro-osseous lesion. In addition, they show equal frequency of involvement of maxilla and mandible with predilection for anterior and premolar parts of jaw, while the conventional variant of ameloblastoma has a predisposition for involvement of the mandible. Immunohistochemically, these tumors are thought to arise from the dental lamina epithelium. So they show they are positive for cytokeratins and other markers which are normally expressed in the tooth germ. So they show expression, and these markers show differential expression within the epithelial cell nest, as you can where calretinin is expressed differentially in the stellate reticulum like cells. As you can see in this example, the stellate reticulum like area expresses calretinin while the peripheral layer of cells are negative. CK13, CK14 and CD56 are expressed in the peripheral cells, while CK19 is expressed in all cells. This pattern of expression can be used to for the diagnosis of ameloblastoma and helps to differentiate it from other odontogenic tumor cells. A variety of molecular aberrations have been discussed, have been implicated in the pathogenesis of ameloblastomas recently. The most common molecular aberration involved the MAPK pathway and the sonic hedgehog pathways. MAPK or mitogen-activated protein kinase pathway. Here the genes mutated are FGFR2, RAS and RAF, in which BRAF is the most commonly mutated gene. In the non-MAPK pathway, the commonest gene which is mutated is MOTEN or SMO, where 16 to 39% of cases show this kind of mutation. These mutations are mutually exclusive except for MOTEN mutated tumors, which occur concomitantly with FGFR2 or RAS mutation. So this graph shows the frequency of mutations which are seen in ameloblastoma, and BRAF V600E mutation is seen in majority of cases, which constitute like around 62% of cases show BRAF V600E mutation, followed by KRAS, NRAS, HRAS, FGFR2, and no mutation is detected in around 8% of cases. In addition to the MAPK pathway mutation and smoothened gene mutation, other mutations are PIK3CA, beta-catenin and SMARCB1 mutations. Interestingly, it was found that ameloblastoma with BRAF mutations show predilection for mandible, as you can see here, while those with smoothened mutations, gene mutations, involve maxilla. And in addition, BRAF mutated tumors occur in younger patients with a mean age of 34 years compared to those without BRAF mutations with a mean age of 54 years. BRAF V600 immunohistochemistry with BRAF 600E specific antibody VE1 may be helpful to identify the BRAF mutated tumors and non-mutated tumors. As you can see in this example, this is a BRAF mutated tumor which expresses the marker, while the negative tumor does not express the marker. So the treatment is wide surgical excision, including an area of bone beyond radiographical margin. In addition, recently BRAF targeted therapy may offer a novel option to complement surgery in selected cases of aggressive and or recurrent ameloblastomas. The second variant of ameloblastoma is unicystic type. It is characterized by a single cystic cavity with or without luminal proliferation. This is the second most common subtype of ameloblastoma, which constitute 5 to 22% of cases. There is a predilection for young individuals, with half of the cases occurring in the second decade. Radiologically, they are well-defined unilocular radiolucency, often associated with an unerupted tooth and mostly involve the mandibular second and third molar tooth. Grossly, as we can see here, it is a single cystic cavity with intraluminal proliferation. Similar to the conventional variant of ameloblastoma, BRAF V600E mutation is common. So initially three morphological types of unicystic ameloblastomas have been described. That is a luminal type, where there is a simple cyst without luminal proliferation, intraluminal type, which is a simple cyst with luminal proliferation, and the mural type, where islands of ameloblastic epithelium can be seen within the cyst wall. Then it was later found that the mural type of unicystic ameloblastomas are more aggressive, and they behave like more like a conventional ameloblastoma. And so it should be considered as a conventional ameloblastoma with prominent cystic change, and should not be categorized as a unicystic ameloblastoma. And so the mural type should be treated like a conventional ameloblastoma and should be excised with a margin. While unicystic ameloblastomas, true unicystic ameloblastomas, that is luminal and intraluminal type, are less aggressive tumors and can be enucleated. So histologically, the luminal type of ameloblastoma is lined by ameloblastic epithelium with an overlying layer of loosely arranged stellate reticulum-like cells. Another characteristic feature is the presence of a prominent band of hyalinization just below the lining epithelium. Intraluminal type of ameloblastomas are characterized by presence of nodular proliferation within the lumen of the cyst, and this nodules on histology may show a plexiform pattern characterized by interconnecting cords of odontogenic epithelium supported by delicate and vascular connective tissue stroma, as you can see here. So next variant is extraosseous or peripheral type of ameloblastoma. This occurs in the soft tissues of the gingiva or edentulous alveolar mucosa, constitutes 1 to 10% of all ameloblastomas. 2/3 of all cases occur in the 5th to 7th decades of life. Males are more commonly affected than females, and there is a predilection for mandibular retromolar area, that is the lingual aspect of mandible, followed by maxillary tuberosity. And they are painless, sessile, exophytic lesions with smooth or papillary and granular surface. No radiographic alterations are seen because they are not involved, they are extraosseous, except for occasional saucerization or pressure erosion of the underlying cortical bone. Histologically, they resemble the conventional type of ameloblastoma and are composed of nests of ameloblastic epithelium. However, they may merge with the overlying squamous mucosa surface epithelium, and which may also exhibit papillary hyperplasia. So the conservative removal with free margin is expected to be curative in extraosseous type of ameloblastoma. The recurrence rate is approximately 16 to 20%. And a long-term follow-up is necessary, as recurrences have been reported as late as 8 years after initial excision. Rare cases of carcinomatous transformation have been documented, and the differential diagnosis may include basal cell carcinoma of oral mucosal origin, extensions from skin tumors or salivary gland epithelial tumors with peripheral palisading pattern. But the presence of typical ameloblastic nests will help to differentiate from these entities. Metastasizing ameloblastoma is the ameloblastoma that metastasizes despite its benign histological appearance, and it is frequently seen in mandible than in maxilla. The primary lesion is usually a solid or multicystic type of ameloblastoma. Metastatic lesions are more commonly seen in lung, followed by lymph nodes and bone. The overall 5-year survival rate is 70%, but the survival depends upon the site of metastasis and surgical accessibility. There is no role for radiotherapy and chemotherapy. So this is an example of metastatic ameloblastoma into the lymph node, where you can see a benign looking ameloblastic nest or odontogenic nest within the epithelial nest within surrounded by the lymphoid tissue. For the diagnosis of metastatic ameloblastoma, Both primary and metastatic lesions must have histologic features of benign ameloblastoma. There are no specific features that predict metastasis, and metastatic ameloblastoma shows significant nuclear ATP, it should be considered as ameloblastic carcinomas. Next entity is squamous odontogenic tumor. It is a benign epithelial odontogenic tumor in which the tumor cells show terminal squamous differentiation. It is very rare, with only less than 50 cases have been published in literature. There is a wide age distribution with a mean age of 38 years, and the male to female ratio is 1.8:1. Usually they are unifocal, and both maxilla and mandible are affected equally. Rarely multifocal and extraosseous tumors have been reported. They are postulated to be derived from the dental lamina rest and rest of malacea or basal epithelium of the oral mucosa. Mutation of ameloblastin gene and expression of Notch receptors and metallothionein have been reported as the causative factor for the squamous odontogenic tumor. Radiologically, it has a characteristic radiologic appearance. It appears as a triangular radiolucency between the teeth, showing the root divergence with the base of the triangle facing towards the root apices. Histologically, these tumors are composed of varying sized nest of squamous epithelium, mature looking or well differentiated squamous epithelium imparting a jigsaw puzzle like architecture, and these nests do not show any peripheral palisading and or cytologic atypia, and the stroma is collagenous. There may be vacuolation of some cells. Mucous metaplasia and sebaceous differentiation have been rarely reported. Differential diagnosis includes squamous cell carcinoma. However, squamous odontogenic tumor as a bland looking appearance, which helps to differentiate it from squamous cell carcinoma. Lack of ameloblastoma like areas helps to differentiate it from acanthomatous ameloblastoma and desmoplastic ameloblastoma. And the treatment and prognosis, most of them, SOTs can be removed conservatively by surgery, and recurrence is rare, and they are less aggressive tumors. Calcifying epithelial odontogenic tumor, CEOT, or it's also known as pinball tumor. They are benign epithelial odontogenic tumor that secretes an amyloid-like protein that tends to calcify. They are also rare, and they constitute less than or equal to 1% of all odontogenic tumors, and has a predilection for second to third decade of life. Males and females are equally affected, and the peak incidence is about a decade earlier in males than in females. There is a striking predilection for involvement of mandible, with mandible is to maxilla ratio of 3:1, and it most commonly involves the premolar and molar region. 6% of cases are extraosseous. They are thought to arise from the stratum intermedium, dental lamina, or reduced enamel epithelium of the enamel organ. PTCH mutations have been reported in these tumors, and so enhanced sonic hedgehog pathway may be responsible for the pathogenesis. Radiologically, they appear as an expanse cell, mixed radiolucent and opaque lesion, and more than half of the cases are associated with an uninterrupted tooth. The characteristic radiologic appearance, which has been described about CEOT, is the driven snow appearance, that is the presence of a radio opaque mass in the center with radiating radio opaque streaks, and this pattern is known as driven snow appearance. But however, this pattern is seen only in a few cases. Histologically, the tumor is characterized by sheets, nests, or strands of polygonal epithelial cells in a fibrous stroma. And characteristic finding is the presence of pools of amyloid-like material, and this material can accumulate intracellularly, creating a cribriform-like pattern. And this amyloid-like material stains positively with Congo red, and it can show apple green birefringence using polarized light. Striking nuclear pleomorphism may be present, as you can see in this example, and do not indicate malignant transformation. Mitoses are not seen, and Ki-67 proliferation index is low. This is a higher power view of CEOT, where you can see polygonal epithelial cells with eosinophilic cytoplasm, and they show prominent desmosomes or intercellular bridges. Amyloid-like material undergo calcification in the form of concentric rings known as Lissigang rings. So amino acid sequencing and mass spectrometry have shown that this amyloid-like material is a unique protein which is provisionally called as AODAM, which is encoded by the exons 5 and 10 of odontogenic amyloblast-associated protein locus. Variation in morphology such as clear cell change, non-calcifying variant with Langhans cells and cystic variants have been reported. Differentials include amyloblastoma. However, COT lacks the peripheral palisading and have amyloid. Clear cell odontogenic carcinoma, the presence of amyloid and lack of EWSR1-ATFN gene rearrangement helps to differentiate it from clear cell odontogenic carcinoma. Metastatic clear cell carcinoma of kidney, because of the presence of calcified matrix and PAXIT negativity, it helps to differentiate it from clear cell carcinoma of kidney. Since the tumor infiltrates the medullary bone, recurrence rate following conservative surgery, conservative local resection is about 15% and malignant transformation can rarely occur. Next entity is adenomatoid odontogenic tumor. It is a benign epithelial tumor that shows duct-like structures. This is also an uncommon tumor and constitutes less than 5% of cases. Females are more commonly affected than males, and it occurs in young patients, with 87% of cases occurring in the second and the third decades of life. There are three clinical radiologic variants: follicular variant, or the variant where the tumor is pericoronal to an impacted tooth; extrafollicular or extracoronal; and peripheral or extraosseous. 95% of cases are intraosseous, and the maxilla is more commonly affected than mandible. And there is a predilection for anterior jaws. Here is another fun fact for you, that is, it is also referred to as a two-thirds tumor, because two-thirds of the cases occurs in female, two-thirds occurs in teenagers, two-thirds of the cases are pericoronal to an impacted tooth, and the pericoronal lesions are usually associated in two-thirds of cases associated with an impacted canine, and two-thirds of cases involve the maxilla. Radiologically, they appear as well-demarcated unilocular radiolucency with fine radio-opaque plaques associated with the crown of an impacted tooth. And because of the limited growth potential or less aggressiveness of this tumor, it is considered to be hamartomas by many authorities. These tumors are very well encapsulated and easily enucleate, as we can see here. And they are composed of sheets, nests, and whorled masses or interlacing cords of spindle-shaped cells with scanty stroma. In addition, there are variably sized rosette or duct-like spaces. This is a higher power view where you can see multiple variably sized nodules composed of spindle-shaped epithelial cells and minimal stroma, and the duct-like structures are lined by columnar or cuboidal epithelium, where the nuclei tend to be displaced away from the lumen, in contrast to amyloblastic epithelium, where the nuclei is face towards the lumen, that is away from the basement membrane. In adenomatoid odontogenic tumor, areas of calcifying epithelial odontogenic tumor or calcifying odontogenic cyst or odontomas can be seen, and these are considered as a part of the histologic spectrum of AOT, and it should be diagnosed as AOT irrespective of the presence of other types of tumors. Strong cytoplasmic expression of beta-catenin has been described. However, no molecular anomaly of beta-catenin has been found within the beta-catenin gene, reflecting a hamartomatous behavior of AOT. They, as I already mentioned, they are encapsulated and they invariably enucleate, and recurrence rates are extremely low. Now let's discuss the benign mixed epithelial and mesenchymal tumors, which includes amyloblastic fibroma, primordial odontogenic tumor, odontomas, which are subclassified into compound and complex types, and dendrogenic ghost cell tumor. Amyloblastic fibroma is a true rare and true mixed tumor, which is composed of odontogenic mesenchyme resembling dental papilla and epithelial tissue resembling odontogenic epithelium. and no dental hard tissues are present. Initially, there were two variants of ameloblastomas, that is ameloblastic fibromas, that is ameloblastic fibrodendinoma, which produces dendin, and ameloblastic fibroodontoma, which produces both dendin and enamel. And these were later found to be developing odontomes and are not considered as distinct entities in the current WHO. They are commonly seen in children and young adults. Sarcomatous transformation can rarely occur. And radiographically, they are characterized by well-defined unilocular or multilocular radiolucencies associated with an impacted tooth, usually molar, in around 80% of cases. Root resorption and cortical perforation are also commonly seen. Conservative curettage is usually curative. So this is a histological appearance of ameloblastic fibroma, which shows long strands of ameloblast-looking cells with rounded ends resembling drumstick. The stroma is cellular and mixoid and fibromyxoid and contains a stellate fibroblast which resembles dental papilla of the tooth forming apparatus. So the odontogenic epithelium, the peripheral cells of the odontogenic epithelium shows a reverse polarization and peripheral palisading, and the central cores may have stellate reticulum like cells. Next entity is primordial odontogenic tumor, which is a recently described tumor. Only 7 cases have been reported till date. It involves children and young adults with the age range of 3 to 19 years. All the reported cases were intraosseous, and there is a striking predilection for mandible, with the mandible to maxilla ratio of 6:1. Grossly, they are solid, well circumscribed, multilobulated, whitish masses without any cystic spaces. Radiologically, they appear as well-defined radiolucency surrounding an embedded tooth, and resorption of the roots of adjacent molar tooth can also be seen. There is an excellent, this tumor shows excellent prognosis on conservative excision. Histologically, it is characterized by variably cellular primitive mesenchymal proliferation that is reminiscent of dental papilla. And the characteristic feature is that the entire periphery of the lesion is covered by odontogenic, a thin layer of odontogenic epithelium, which is composed of cuboidal cells with focal evidence of peripheral palisading. Next entity is odontoma. Odontoma is a mixed epithelial and mesenchymal tumor-like malformation or hamartomas, which are composed of dental, hard and soft tissues. This is the most common odontogenic tumor slash tumor-like malformation. There are two subtypes. Compound type shows multiple small tooth-like structures, and the complex type appears as irregular masses of dentin and enamel with no anatomic resemblance to the tooth. They occur in the first 2 decades of life and shows no gender predilection. Maxilla is more commonly affected than mandible. They are usually asymptomatic and may be associated with an unerupted tooth. Multifocal odontomas or supernumerary teeth may occur in patients with Gardner syndrome or familial colorectal polyposis. So the radiological features of odontomas are characteristic or they are diagnostic, and they appear as a well-demarcated radio-opaque lesion resembling a tooth-like structure situated between the root or crown of an impacted tooth, and there is a thin layer of radiolucent zone surrounding this radio-opaque lesion. Complex odontoma is characterized by a well-demarcated radiolucency with a central dense radio-opacity as a result of calcification, and it is associated with an impacted molar tooth as in this example. And complex odontomas can radiologically resemble other calcified odontogenic tumors. Grossly, compound odontomas look like appears as a cluster of white tooth-like structures or dendicles of varying size and shape, and histologically they maintain the normal layers of the tooth, that is the pulp, which is covered by dentin, and then there is a layer of enamel followed by cementum and the adjacent fibrous connective tissue, which is consistent with dental papilla, as you see in the developing tooth, is also seen. Whereas complex odontoma shows more shows a disorganized or a haphazard arrangement of pulpal structures, tubular dentin and enamel. As you can see in this example, there is this tubular dentin with clefts of basophilic enameloid matrix, which is haphazardly distributed. This is a higher power view of this area where you can see the basaloid enameloid matrix This is the mature enamel and this is dentin. As a result of decalcification, the mature enamel is lost, leaving behind hollow structures as you can see here. The dentin and enamel matrix are usually associated with odontogenic epithelium. And if a soft tissue capsule is present, it shows presence of immature connective tissue and islands of ameloblastic epithelium resembling the appearance of ameloblastic fibroma. Next entity is dentinogenic host cell tumor. It is a benign, locally infiltrating neoplasm of odontogenic origin. It is also very rare and it constitutes less than 3% of cases, and only 45 cases have been reported. Males are twice more commonly affected than females, and the peak age is 40 to 60 years with a predilection for mandible. Because of the rarity of this lesion, the optimal management or treatment is not known, and the recommended treatment is wide local excision. And this tumor shows WNT signaling pathway mutation has a role in the development of this tumor, which has been shown by the presence of beta catenin gene mutations and nuclear and cytoplasmic expression of beta catenin ISC. This is a histology of dentinogenic host cell tumor, which shows predominantly sheets of anastomosing cords and strands of odontogenic epithelium. And the odontogenic epithelium is lined by cells with uniform basophilic nuclei with clear to pale eosinophilic cytoplasm, and microcyst formation can be seen. And in addition, the background may show stellate reticulum-like cells. In addition to these, there is also aberrant keratinization, and variable number of host cells can be seen. Host cells are enucleate cells with which has a pale eosinophilic cytoplasm and has cytoplasmic vacuolations, which are the location of the previously resorbed nuclei. They also show presence of dendinoid or cementum-like matrix, and the close differential is ameloblastoma with host cells. But the proportion of host cells in dendinogenic host cell tumor is usually more than 1 to 2%, and the presence of dendinoid also helps to differentiate it from ameloblastoma. These tumors, as I already mentioned, WNT signaling pathway has a role in the pathogenesis, and they show expression of nuclear positivity for beta catenin, as you can see in this picture. Benign mesenchymal odontogenic tumors include odontogenic fibroma, odontogenic myxoma or myxofibroma, cementoblastoma, and cemento-ossifying fibroma. Odontogenic fibroma is a rare neoplasm which is composed of mature fibrous connective tissue with variable amounts of inactive-looking odontogenic epithelium with or without evidence of calcification. The clinical variants are intraosseous or central odontogenic fibroma and extraosseous or peripheral odontogenic fibroma, which is more common. Females are twice more commonly affected than males, and maxilla and mandible are equally affected. Peripheral type has a predilection for anterior gingiva. These tumors are not aggressive and there was no recurrence following simple curettage. Histologically, they have moderately cellular or collagenous mature connective tissue stroma and variably sized variable number of scattered odontogenic epithelium which are inactive looking. That is, they do not show evidence of peripheral palisading or reverse polarization. In addition, mineralized dendinoid or cementum like calcification associated with odontogenic epithelium has also been reported. Amyloid like deposits can also be seen. Another variant of odontogenic fibroma is the granular cell odontogenic tumor, which is characterized by granular cell change of the stromal cells, as you can see here. Next entity is odontogenic myxoma or myxofibroma. This is the third most common tumor following odontoma and ameloblastoma. There is a wide age range of occurrence with a mean age of 28 years. Females are twice more commonly affected than males. Mandible is more commonly affected than maxilla, and rare extraosseous cases have been reported. These tumors are rarely associated with tuberous sclerosis and nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome, but they are not related to genetically. They are not related genetically to carni complex, which is the predisposing factor for soft tissue myxomas. They are locally infiltrative and the treatment is similar to that of ameloblastoma. Here you can see the radiologic appearance of odontogenic myxoma. It can be unilocular or multilocular radiolucent lesion with fine soap bubble or honeycomb appearance. Occasionally they show fine straight or crisscross septae like tennis racket like trabeculations. Grossly, they are whitish glistening tumor mass that fills the bony cavity with minimal true encapsulation. Histologically, these tumors are characterized by randomly arranged stellate to spindle-shaped cells with fine, pale, eosinophilic, long cytoplasmic processes. Sometimes they can be binucleated or they can show mild nuclear atypia and mitotic figures can be seen. Histologically, they closely resemble the dental papilla and the dental follicle of the developing tooth. And also they can mimic a hyperplastic dental follicle, which is associated with an unerupted or an impacted tooth. However, the hyperplastic dental follicle is usually covered by at least focally by reduced enamel epithelium, which helps to differentiate it from myxoma, which is a very infiltrative tumor. Fragments of bone which are actually residual trabeculae can be seen. In addition, there can be dystrophic calcification and odontogenic rests are also seen. And this myxoid matrix is strongly positive for Alcyon blue and also PAS. If there is the stroma is more collagenous, it is termed as myxofibroma or fibromyxoma. Next entity is cementoblastoma. This is also a rare tumor with only 100 cases have been reported. 1 to 6%, it constitutes 1 to 6% of all odontogenic tumors. Age range is 8 to 44 years, and 3/4 of the cases occur in under 30 years of age. It has a striking predilection for mandible, with the mandibular more than 75% of cases occurring in the mandibular molars and premolars. Here, this is the radiologic appearance, which is pathognomonic of cementoblastoma. It is a it occurs as a well-circumscribed radio-opaque mass, which is attached to the root of an involved tooth with a surrounding radiolucent zone. Treatment of choice is complete excision of the mass with the removal of the affected tooth. So the histology is the reflection of radiological finding. Here you can see this is a whole mount view of the tooth with cementoblastoma, where you can see the tumor mass attached to the root of the tooth, and this tumor has a well-defined, well-demarcated border, and it is separated from the adjacent bone by a fine layer, by a thin layer of fibrous tissue. Histologically, this tumor is composed of thick radiating trabeculae of cementum, and the cementum shows irregular basophilic reversal lines similar to that seen in Paget's disease with intervening fibrovascular connective tissue stroma. And these trabeculae are lined by plump, active looking cementoblasts. And this morphology histology resembles osteoblastoma. However, the attachment of this mass to the root of the tooth helps to differentiate it from osteoblastoma. Cementoossifying fibroma is a benign fibrosis lesion that occurs in the tooth-bearing areas of the jaws, and it is believed to be of odontogenic origin. There are three variants: cementoossifying fibroma, juvenile trabecular ossifying fibroma, juvenile samometoid ossifying fibroma. This cementoossifying fibroma is discussed in detail under the heading of ossifying fibromas and osteochondromatous lesions of the maxillofacial bone, and detailed discussion about this entity is beyond the scope of this presentation. Now let's deal with the malignant odontogenic tumors. Among the odontogenic carcinoma, we have ameloblastic carcinoma, primary intraosseous carcinoma, not otherwise specified, sclerosing odontogenic carcinoma, clear cell odontogenic carcinoma, and ghost cell carcinoma. And we also have odontogenic carcinosarcoma and odontogenic sarcomas. Ameloblastic carcinoma is a malignant counterpart of ameloblastoma. It can be either de novo, which is known as primary type, and secondary as a result of malignant transformation of a pre-existing or recurrent ameloblastoma. It most commonly affects the sixth decade of life with the average age of 50 years. Males are twice more commonly affected than females. Most frequent sites are mandible and posterior jaws. And radiologically, they appear as irregular radiolucency of mandible, as you can see here, that cause perforation of the cortical plate and displacement of the adjacent indication. And they are treated by complete surgical resection with 2 to 3 bony margins, with or without neck dissection. Lung metastasis is common. Cervical node involvement is not very common. Histologically, they show the typical morphology of ameloblastoma, that is presence of ameloblasticness, islands of ameloblastic epithelium with peripheral palisading and reverse polarization and stellate reticulum-like cells, but with features of malignancy, that is increased mitotic figures, nuclear atypia, and apoptosis and necrosis. In this example, you can see that highly atypical cells with peripheral palisading and nuclear reverse polarization of the nuclei. Sometimes when the tumor becomes more aggressive, there is loss of ameloblastoma like architecture, and the central stellate reticulum like area of the tumor undergoes becomes develop into a high grade spindle cell, or they may develop into high grade basaloid cells, or they may show squamous differentiation. They may differentiate into atypical squamous cells. The amount of necrosis also varies. It can vary from, it can range from clusters of apoptotic cells, as you can see in this example, to large areas of necrosis and comedonecrosis. These tumors express SOX2 and have a higher Ki-67 labeling index. And the cutoff that has been mentioned in the article is more than 20%. When compared to benign tumors, and this helps to differentiate it from benign tumors, and they also show BRAF mutation similar to ameloblastomas. Primary intraosseous carcinoma is the terminology which is used for any central jaw carcinoma that cannot be categorized as any other type of carcinoma. It includes primary intraosseous squamous cell carcinoma and carcinoma arising in odontogenic cysts. The thought to arise from the rest of dental lamina or epithelial rests of series or a rest of malassez. And before considering a diagnosis of primary intraosseous carcinoma, one should exclude its origin from oral mucosa, overlying skin, andral mucosa, nasal mucosa, or metastasis from a distant primary. This is a rare tumor. About 116 cases have been reported from arising from the odontogenic cyst, and 35 cases were de novo. Both those arising from the cyst as well as de novo cases showed a predominance in males, that is, males were involved twice more commonly than females. Median patient age was 55 to 60 years. However, some cases have been reported in children. There is a predilection for posterior body and ramus of mandible, and the maxillary lesions occur in the anterior segment. Histologically, they are characterized by varying islands of atypical squamous cells in a collagenous stroma, and these atypical cells do not show evidence of ameloblastic differentiation, and the epithelial cells have eosinophilic glassy cytoplasm and spinous process suggestive of brittle cell layer differentiation. And these tumors are either well differentiated or moderately differentiated tumors, and necrosis is not described. Sometimes in situ change or verrucous dysplastic change can occur in the lining epithelium of odontogenic cysts, and these tumors behave as in situ lesions if they are limited to the cyst. Radicular or residual cysts are the most common precursors of primary intraosseous carcinoma, followed by dendrigerous cyst and odontogenic keratosis. Prognosis is generally poor and depends upon the histological grade. Radical resection is the primary treatment modality with neck dissection if there is metastasis. The differential diagnosis includes squamous odontogenic tumor, which lack the cytologic atypia seen in the primary intraosseous carcinoma. Acanthomatous ameloblastoma shows ameloblastic differentiation, which is absent in this entity. Intraosseous mucoepidermoid carcinoma shows mucous cells. And squamous cell carcinoma of oral mucosa, it is, if there is surface ulceration, it is impossible to distinguish it from squamous cell carcinoma arising from the oral mucosa. To rule out metastatic carcinoma, clinical radiological correlation and PET CT scan is required. Next entity is sclerosing odontogenic carcinoma. This is a recently described entity, first described in 2008. Less than 10 cases have been reported till date. Males and females are equally affected. The premolar and molar regions of mandible are affected more than maxilla. It is a low-grade carcinoma and the treatment is resection. And there is no role for radiotherapy and metastasis is not described. This is a histology of sclerosing odontogenic tumor, which is composed of cords and nests of cells that infiltrate a collagenous stroma. The epithelial cells may range from cords, single cords of epithelial cells, single file epithelial cells to nests of cells resembling odontogenic rest. And the stroma is highly collagenized and eosinophilic, and it compresses the epithelium. And hence, sometimes it is difficult to identify these the tumor cells on symbol HNE, and it may require immunohistochemistry for cytokeratin. In this example, you can see the CK19 highlighting the tumor cells. And the tumor cells are predominantly bland looking, with some showing mild nuclear atypia, and mitosis is rare. Despite the bland appearance, these tumors are highly infiltrative. As you can see in this example, the tumor cells are infiltrating the muscle fibers, and the presence of perineural invasion is characteristic. Immunohistochemically, they are positive for CK19, CK56, and P63, like any odontogenic tumors. And focally, they are weakly positive for CK7, while they are negative for CAMP5.2. And E-catherine expression is variable. It can show partial membrane or incomplete membrane expression of E-catherine. Differential diagnosis considered include epithelium-rich central odontogenic fibroma, and this actually resembles sclerosing odontogenic carcinoma, but it can be differentiated from sclerosing odontogenic carcinoma because of the presence of infiltrating growth in SOC. Calcifying epithelial odontogenic tumor has amyloid-like protein deposit, which helps to differentiate it from SOC. And desmoplastic amyloblastic carcinoma shows reverse polarization of the epithelium, which is absent in SOC. Next entity is clear cell odontogenic carcinoma. It is a rare odontogenic tumor with around 100 cases reported in literature. And it is characterized by presence of numerous glycogen-rich clear epithelial cells. And the females are more commonly affected than males. The age group which is affected is, ranges from 40 to 70 years, with a mean age of 53 years. Mandible is 3 times more commonly involved than maxilla, and 43% of them occurs in the posterior body and lower ramus. Derivation, these tumors are thought to be derived from the clear cell rest of the primary or the primitive dental lamina. 80% of clear cell odontogenic carcinomas show EWSR1 ATF1 translocation. Even with these are aggressive tumors, and even with surgical resection, local recurrences in up to 1/3 of patients and distant metastasis to lung has been reported in 10% of patients. Histologically, they are characterized by presence of island, infiltrating islands and nests and sheets of odontogenic epithelium composed of clear cells and small basaloid cells. 3 morphological patterns have been described, that is the biphasic pattern, where you can see clear cells with abundant clear or pale eosinophilic cytoplasm with well-defined cytoplasmic borders, and the periphery shows small basophilic cells with scanty eosinophilic cytoplasm. In the monophasic type, there is a complete cytoplasmic clearing, and this monophasic type can also show peripheral palisading and reverse polarity, and this pattern is also known as amyloblastis pattern, which is the 3rd pattern. The clear cytoplasm of the tumor cells are glycogen rich, and they are positive for PAS and diastase labi, and these cells are positive for CK14, CK19 and A1, A3, suggestive of odontogenic origin. And the tumor nuclei may be bland looking, but with the when the tumor becomes more aggressive, the cytologic and nuclear atypia increases, degree of cytologic and nuclear atypia increases, and there will be vascular and perineural invasion and necrosis. Differential diagnosis include melanoma and metastatic renal carcinoma, which require broad ISC panel, including S100, melanie, Paxate, to rule out these metastatic tumors. And clear cell variant of calcifying epithelial odontogenic tumor and ameloblastoma with clear cell differentiation shows only focal clear cell change, whereas clear cell odontogenic carcinoma shows predominant clear cell change. And clear cell carcinoma of salivary gland, it is sometimes indistinguishable to distinguish to separate it from clear cell carcinoma of salivary gland, because this tumor also shows the same translocation, that is EWSR1 ATF1 translocation. However, radiology might help to confirm the odontogenic origin of this tumor. Ghost cell odontogenic carcinoma is the next entity, which is rare and constitute less than 3% of all cases, and 40 cases have been reported. Males are there is a striking predilection for males, with the males predisposition for males. Males are 4 times more commonly involved than females. The age range is 11 to 79 years, with a mean age of 39.7 years. And the maxilla is predominantly involved than mandible. 40% of the cases arise from calcifying odontogenic cyst or a dendrogenic odontogenic tumor, which are a group of tumors producing ghost cells. Since they have unpredictable behavior, currently wide excision is a primary mode of treatment. Histologically, they show sheets, strands and islands of small basaloid to large pleomorphic cells in a fibrous or hyalinized stroma. Mitotic figures are frequently seen. The characteristic feature is the presence of ghost cells, as similar to that of dendrogenic ghost cell tumor, which are large, rounded, pale eosinophilic cells with empty central nuclear spaces, which actually got resorbed. And these ghost cells are supposed to be keratinizing cells with aberrant terminal differentiation. Dendrinoid formation may also be seen. Next entity is odontogenic carcinosarcoma. This is extremely rare, and architecturally they resemble ameloblastic fibroma with cellular mesenchymal stroma and variable number of ameloblastic epithelium with reverse polarization and peripheral palisading. However, it shows evidence of malignancy in the form of cytologic nuclear ATP and mitosis involving both the epithelium as well as the stroma. As you can see here, there are increased number of mitotic figures and cytologic ATP. The typical ameloblastic features such as peripheral palisading and inner stellate reticulum like cells may be lost focally. Odontogenic sarcomas are a rare group of mixed odontogenic tumors in which epithelial component is cytologically benign and mesenchymal component shows cytological features of malignancy. There are 3 different types. Ameloblastic fibrosarcoma is a malignant counterpart of ameloblastic fibroma, and this is the most common type. Ameloblastic fibrodendinosarcomas produce dendin and dendinoid, and ameloblastic fibroodontosarcoma produce enamel, enameloid and dendin. Here in this picture you can see the benign looking odontogenic epithelium, and the stroma is highly cellular and malignant looking with cytologic atypia and increased mitosis. Now let's see the odontogenic cysts. I'll be discussing only the most commonly seen odontogenic cysts in the regular practice, that is radicular cyst, dendrigerous cyst and odontogenic keratosis. So a radicular cyst is an odontogenic cyst of inflammatory origin, always associated with a non-vital teeth. This is a very important point in the diagnosis, and it is associated mostly located at the root apex, as you can see here. And a residual cyst is a radicular cyst that remains in the jaws after extraction of the affected tooth. This is the most common cyst of the jaws and constitute 55% of all odontogenic cysts, and they are thought to originate from epithelial rest, cell rest of melasse due to inflammation and pulpal necrosis and due to dental caries. Commonest site is maxilla, with 50% of the cases arising in the anterior region. Radiology shows a well-demarcated radiolucency at the apex of a non-vital tooth. This is a whole mount view of the lesion, where you can see a cyst attached to the apex of a root of the tooth, and it is composed of an inflamed wall, which is aligned by an epithelium, and the lumen is filled with necrotic cell debris. Histologically, the fibrous inflamed cyst wall is lined by stratified squamous epithelium, which undergoes proliferation and with elongated retail ridges, creating an arcading pattern. And the cyst wall shows mixed inflammation and cholesterol cleft formation and foreign body giant cell reaction. In addition to that, the squamous epithelial lining may show numerous eosinophilic, hyalinized, irregular and curvilinear bodies known as the Rushton bodies. The origin of these tumors are not known exactly, and they are thought to arise from thought to be secreted by the odontogenic epithelium, or they may be hematogenous or vascular in origin. And the squamous epithelial cells may also undergo mucinous metaplasia, and you can see the mucus cells here. The indigerous cyst is the second most common cyst, and which constitute 20% of cases. 10 to 30 years is the peak incidence, with a female male to female ratio of 3:2. It is a developmental cyst, with the wall of the cyst surrounds the crown of the unerupted tooth, and it is attached to the cemento-enamel junction. As you can see here in the gross picture, here is a cyst which is attached to the, which covers the crown of the tooth and is attached to the cemento-enamel junction, the junction between the crown and the root of the tooth. And the epithelial lining is derived from the reduced enamel epithelium, which covers the crown of an unerupted tooth. And this is because of the fluid accumulation between, they arise as a result of fluid accumulation between the reduced enamel epithelium and the crown of an unerupted tooth. Radiologically, they are a well demarcated, corticated radiolucency enveloping the crown of an impacted tooth. This is a whole mount view where you can see the cyst which is attached to the junction of the cemento-enamel junction. And the cyst wall is lined by a thin layer of non-keratinizing squamous epithelium, 2 to 4 cell layers thick. And the cyst wall is loose and fibrous within, and it may show odontogenic rest. As a result of secondary inflammation, the squamous epithelium can undergo thickening and with the downward proliferation of retail ridges. And mucinous metaplasia has also been described. The last entity is odontogenic keratocyst, which was also known as keratocystic odontogenic tumor previously. And this constitutes 10 to 20% of cysts. And this is the third most common cyst and commonly seen in second to third decades of life. 5% of these cases are part of the nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome or the Gorlin syndrome. If they are associated with the syndrome, you can see multiple odontogenic keratocysts, and they occur in younger patients. This is a developmental odontogenic cyst, which is thought to arise from the remnants of dental lamina epithelium. Mutation or inactivation of PTCH1 gene resulting in activation of the sonic hedgehog signaling pathway has been described. And this causes the aberrant cell proliferation of the odontogenic keratocyst, epithelium of the odontogenic keratocyst. 80% of the cases occur in the mandible. And those in the posterior maxilla are usually associated with Gorlin syndrome. Here you can see the radiologic finding, which is a well-demarcated radiolucent lesion associated with a corticated margin. And in this example, it is located in the right mandible. This is treated by enucleation or by surgical resection of large lesions. It is controversial whether the odontogenic keratocyst should be classified as an odontogenic cyst or an odontogenic tumor. However, it is important to recognize this entity due to the following features. That is, because of the greater growth potential, it has a greater growth potential than most other odontogenic cysts and shows higher recurrence rate, and there is a possible association with nevoid basal cell carcinoma syndrome. Histologically, as a result of enucleation, they are usually received as fragmented bits, and the cyst is lined by stratified squamous epithelium of 4 to 5 layers thick, and the characteristic feature is that the parakeratinized surface shows corrugation, is corrugated, and the basal layer is well defined, and it shows palisading as well as subnuclear vacuolation. And they have typically an uninflamed fibrous wall. Another feature is other features are presence of basal cell budding and presence of satellite cysts and islands in the wall. Occasional solid variant, which is composed of multiple cyst-like structures and odontogenic nests in a fibrous stroma, has also been reported. So these are my references. I have included some references along with my slides. These are the remaining ones. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Wonderful.
Thank you, Dr. Mani.
Yeah, very detailed and very nicely done. And there were some questions which put up by Dr. Pranab Bhattacharya. I have sent you it on your WhatsApp. You can answer them directly to him.
Okay.
That will be not an issue, right? And wonderfully done, Dr. Indu. Excellent presentation. Thank you for taking out time. Just one thing which I wanted to know is, which is the most commonest of the tumors which you see in your practice?
Ameloblastomas.
Yeah, that's it. We all see the ameloblastomas. Yeah. And with regards... Yeah, please.
We had a case of clear cell odontogenic carcinoma, but I couldn't include it in my presentation, which is also a rare entity. Right. Clear cell odontogenic carcinoma, right. which also we have got one case. We had a case of ameloblastic fibroma and a desmoblastic ameloblastoma. I have put the pictures of that also.
Yeah, I saw that. One very common problem which we face at times in our practices regarding the cysts, most of the time they are very fragmented and many a times they are so inflamed that the lining will not be very clearly visible. And then it becomes very difficult to exactly classify them into one or the other.
So radiology is helpful in that because these cysts, they are attached, their location is different. Their attachment and their association with the tooth has been differently explained. Yeah.
Correct, right. Thank you, Dr. Indu. Wonderful presentation.
Thank you, sir.
We would like to have you back here with something more, maybe your triple negative breast tumor that is long due.
Yeah,
maybe sometime when you are free, we would like to hear that from you. Right?
Sure. Yeah.
So let us know when you are free, and so we will try to have you here back with the triple negative breast tumors. That's much in demand. Everybody wants to know exactly what it is and how to handle that. Right?
Sure.
Thank you. Take care. Bye-bye. Good night.
Bye. Thank you so much.
God bless you. Bye-bye. Thanks.